Redeemer lives. Amen? Amen. And we've seen how Sophia has grown in her giftings from the Lord. Let's give God the glory. Amen? And there's many more among the youth that will grow also in the area of their giftings and abilities in the Lord. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for you live. And because you live, we can live also, God. And Lord, we can live with meaning, with purpose, with joy, with certainty, O God, that you hold our hands. And God, we know that you're coming very soon, and we pray that you give us a sense of urgency, O God, in the way we live, to listen to your voice, O God, and to obey your word and to obey your leading, and to allow the Holy Spirit to manifest himself through us for your greater glory and honor, that we may live as witnesses to your great miracles, to great wonders, O God, to people getting saved, to people getting changed, one family at a time, one person at a time. Lord, let your word come alive this morning and speak individually, O God, to every person present here. We even pray, O God, for families that are not here. Lord, wherever they are, may they worship you as well and fellowship with the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How's everyone this morning? God is good? God is good? Not too many people are declaring that, huh? So this morning, God has laid a topic, right? The Spirit-filled life, trying versus training. I'm reading a book, The Life You've Always Wanted, and what I gleaned from that book was a lot of Christians are focused so much on trying to live the Christian life when we should be training in Christian life, in our Christian life. And so just some statistics to share with you, based on statistics done by Barna, who does a lot of studies among churches and areas of faith. 66% of Christians or believers consider themselves, based on the survey, as casual Christians. What does casual Christians mean? You have your papers with you. You can fill that out as we go along, and you can make sure to study that when you get home. That way, you know, the word of God that we share together will sink deeper, and you understand, and you can apply, and you can even share it with others. And so I purposely put three holes there, so you start putting them in binders, right? Because you can use that eventually in a Bible study or just one-on-one with a friend. So what does casual Christian mean? Are people who like to stay in the comfort zone, you know, where they are, happy, safe, you know, in the comfort, in the confines of the church environment. And mostly, they live a life of compromise because they want to live in peace. Of course, there's nothing wrong with living in peace, but sometimes these kinds of Christians, casual Christians, sacrifice their moral values in order to just live peaceably, which is not what God wants us. And a lot of these casual Christians live in moderation. You know, we hear the advertisement, drink moderately, right? But in a Christian life, I don't think that we can survive this world by just being a moderate Christian. Would you agree? Amen? And so there's a difference, right, with the other percentage, which is the captive, or I would prefer to call it a causal Christian. So it's just easy, right? You switch the letters and you can become a casual or you become a causal Christian. Causal Christians only are 16%. These people are always in the conflict zone in spiritual warfare. And these people are characterized by passion and compassion for people. And they're all out for Jesus. People call them crazy. People call them weird. But they're all out for Jesus. And I hope you and I will be called causal Christians because you cause things to happen for the kingdom of God. Amen. You cause the Holy Spirit to move through you and impact those around you and do the will of God for you and your family and the lives that you touch on a daily basis. So, casual versus causal Christian. Which one are we? Which one are you? One of the phrases I learned, or the quotes I learned in our business, is if you can't stand for something, let's read this all together. If you can't stand for something, you will fall for anything. Isn't that true? If you don't make a stand for your moral values, for your biblical beliefs, then you will fall for anything that comes your way, that sounds good to you, that tickles your ears, that makes you, gives you convenience. So we'd better make a decision whether we're going to be a casual Christian or a causal Christian and take a stand for what we believe in Jesus Christ. This is also like a semi-testimony of what happened to me when I got hospitalized with Guillain-Barré syndrome, GBS. And like, I'd like you, for you to close your eyes for a while. Close your eyes. Imagine that you cannot move. You can't move your arms, can't move your legs, and you're having a hard time breathing. But your mind is alert, you can think, but your speech is starting to slur. It's hard to imagine that, but that was the place I was during the acute phase of my disease. But I realized, right, that God had purpose for that time, that short period of time. Like Dr. Karongkong said, you just wake up and it's going to be just like a dream. And that's exactly what happened. A month in the hospital, right, 7 days in ICU, 10 days in rehab. I got out in February 1st. I got in January the 4th. And God has just speedily recovered by His grace. And it's just incredible. I know that science can say, oh, you're going to get recovered, right? But they give you 6 months to a year or even longer than that to recover. And I just praise God that it took less than a month for me to start walking without the cane. At first, I was on a wheelchair, and then a walker, and then a cane, and then I was walking just, you know, just carefully so I won't fall. And just last weekend, I wasn't here because I attended our 25 years reunion with my School of Nursing alumni, And I just blessed God because that was a precious time. 25 years we haven't seen each other. And I thought I was going to miss that because I got sick. But I'm just so blessed I was able to minister to my classmates, former classmates. And just to see them also serving the Lord in their own capacity wherever God has placed them. That's precious to me. And so I just want to glean on the five areas of casuality. Five areas where casual Christians have become casual or are casual about. There's no word as casuality. I looked it up. So I just made that up. Five areas where people can become casual. You can add maybe, I just put them all in letter I so it's easy to remember. Shall we read them all? Number one is in intercession. Number two is in intimacy. Third is in instruction. Fourth is in interaction. And fifth is in influence. These areas where people, Christians, have become casual or are still in casual stage. When I was in the hospital, I realized, even before I got to the hospital at home, I was vomiting a lot. I had the stomach flu. That was the presenting symptoms of my Guillain-Barré. And I realized that as I was experiencing that discomfort, you know, nonstop vomiting until there's nothing to puke out, like greens coming out already. And I realized, Lord, I've just been so casual, number one, with my intercession for Lutz and Arlene Sagayo. These precious people in our church are diagnosed with cancer. They've been through chemo. And you know, chemo patients have nausea a lot, vomiting from the side effects. And as I experienced that stomach flu with so much vomiting, I realized, Lord, this is how they feel. Or even worse. And they have to deal with this day in, day out when they go through chemo. And I'm just so casual praying, Lord, heal Luz, heal Arlene, without intensity. Because I didn't know that that was how it felt. Probably I had an idea as a nurse, but going through that discomfort changed me. And I said, Lord, help me to be more intense in my prayer for others. Because I know when it's our need, when it concerns our family, we can cry and kneel to the Lord because it concerns us. Amen? But when it's for others, we got to let the Holy Spirit pray through us. Because that's what intercession is, praying to God in behalf of others. Romans 8:26 says, right? In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. How many have experienced praying, just groaning and crying and wailing to the Lord? No words come out anymore. Amen? And usually, that's when you pray for a family member, a loved one who's sick, who's going through tough times, who's going through tragedy. Can we do that as well for our brethren and even for unbelievers that give us a prayer request? To allow the Holy Spirit to pray through us and intercede for them, for their situation, that God will do a mighty miracle of deliverance, the blessings that they need and desire. The answer to prayers that have been prayed for so long. Amen? Because the Holy Spirit will help us. One of the things, you know, I realize if you are not baptized yet in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, I want you to go to your prayer closet one of these days and just imagine yourself as a mute person, where a mute person cannot word out what he wants to say, right? And so you just groan out your praise, groan out your adoration to the Lord, and allow the Holy Spirit to just flow through you and allow the gift of tongues to manifest in your life, in your private life, right? Some of you are hesitant to do it during the congregational worship, but I pray that in your personal devotional life, you speak to the Lord in tongues, you pray to the Lord in tongues, because the devil cannot understand that heavenly language, right? Sometimes when we pray in the words we understand, the devil can hear us and he can just give you distractions and all that, but the heavenly language, it's just between you and God. Amen. So intercede with groaning for us. And Ephesians 6:18 says, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. And with this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. So didn't you notice a lot of alls in just that one verse? So it's all inclusive, all occasions, right? Whatever the need is, all kinds of prayer, be it thanksgiving or supplication or asking for requests, right, before the Lord. And always keep on praying for all the Lord's people, God's people. So I hope you and I develop a prayer list of needs, and you journal what God has done regarding that prayer, so you'll be encouraged and others will be encouraged as well when you share that testimony. You know, when I told you to close your eyes and imagine that you can't move, I realized that that was how Kuya Amor felt, the husband of Doc Karungkong, because he can't move, but his mind is alert and awake. And I again went through that, and so I became more intense in praying for Doc's husband. Because again, we can just pray, Lord, heal the brother Amor, and you know, just like an automatic thing. But when we travail, because we know that such is a hard place to be, you're awake, but you can't do anything about your physical body. You can't even turn yourself to side to avoid bed sores. That's tough. You lose all control physically, but your mind is still working. So you have to really fully, totally depend on the Lord. And that was the position I was in when I got sick with Guillain-Barre. And so let's intercede, because you don't know what that person is going through at that moment, is needing a divine intervention in their life. I heard of a testimony of a pastor's son while he was in Egypt. His mom and dad were praying for him. Suddenly, he just felt urged to really intercede in his behalf. They don't know what's going on, right? And so it so happened that that son was in like a coffee shop, like open air coffee shop. And for some reason, he moved away from that spot where he usually takes his coffee and breakfast, right? And he moves away from that spot for some reason, because there was a bomb that exploded, of a suicide bomber came. And, you know, God just delivered their son just in time, because they interceded. So we never know when God, when the Holy Spirit urges us to pray for someone, let's obey. Let's don't postpone it, because there is a need at that moment for whoever comes to your mind. Or you promise, okay, I'll pray for that, and you forget about it, right? Someone tells you, oh, sister, brother, please pray for me about this. And you say, okay, we'll pray for that, but you forget. Let's make sure that when we say we pray, we will really pray, because there is a need. And it may totally depend on you standing in the gap for the Lord to work in their lives. That's what we do when we intercede. We stand in the gap to bridge the need, so that God's answer may come upon the need of your friend, of your brother, or your family member. Stand in the gap. You may say, oh, God knows their needs already. I don't know, for some reason, God just desires and answers desperate prayer. Because it's not for his benefit, it's for our benefit. We become changed, our character gets molded when we are more desperate in our prayers, especially for others as well. You know, I love this testimony of Jim Simbala. He's the pastor of Brooklyn Tabernacle. You know, before they got so big, before they had a big building, they were having four services because they couldn't accommodate in just one service the growing population in Brooklyn. And so they didn't have much money, but he realized the need when a single mom and her kid had to be turned away from the congregation sanctuary and ended up watching the service in the lobby on TV. Because there was no more space in the sanctuary and there was no more space for the kid in the Sunday school rooms. So mom and daughter had to just watch the entire service in the lobby watching TV. And so he said, God, this is not what you want. Because it's distracting when you have a kid with you watching, right? We want this young lady to grow and be ministered to, and that child to grow also in Sunday school. And so long story short, they prayed about it. They interceded for the need. And so long story short again, an old theater in downtown Brooklyn got available. It was built 1918. It can house 4,000 plus. Plus it had three other buildings for offices. And they prayed about that. And God just opened the doors. He was an author of a book, and he became a guest to 700 Club. And so he just mentioned, you know, that they're moving forward, looking at a need for a bigger church building. And so the following week, Pat Robertson sent him a letter pledging $1 million. We never know how God can surprise us when we intercede for a need, when our hearts are pure and we desire what's best according to God's will for us and for our families and for our friends and for the people that God brings our way. Amen? So don't underestimate the power of intercession. Let's be on fire, on zeal, zealous about praying, and not be casual Christians in the area of standing in the gap. Second area where we can be casual is in our intimacy or our worship with God. I can see your heart. God sees our hearts when we worship. Whether we are casual when we stand before the presence of the Lord on Sundays, but the best way to train for worship is behind closed doors. Amen. Who you are when you're by yourself before God in your personal devotional time with the Lord. It may just be 5 minutes or 15 minutes or 30 minutes or an hour, but you have that special date with God, a communion with the Father, with the Holy Spirit, with Jesus, where the cares of this world cannot distract you or disturb you. And we need to upgrade our level of intimacy with God. Amen. How many of you on a scale of 1 to 10 are already on a 10 in your intimacy with God? So we all have room to grow. Amen. And it takes not trying, but training. Because trying always leads to failure, but training, regularly doing it, growing it, maybe 5 minutes, start it 5 minutes every day, right? Early morning or late at night, whatever kind of personality you are, night person or day person. Train yourself, train ourselves, and the Holy Spirit will give the self-control. Amen? Amen. It takes 21 days to break and form a habit, so we got to do it regularly on a daily basis. So grow in intimacy. God is looking for true worshipers. And I pray that this morning he has found true worshipers here among us. Amen. Not just a few of us, but I pray that God has found all of us as true worshipers in spirit and in truth. That's why we need the Holy Spirit, because only the Holy Spirit can teach us how to best worship the Father. Amen. And let's read Psalm 27 verse 8. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. How many of you have played hide and seek before? Right? And when you're the it, you do your best to look for everyone, to seek for them, so that you can not be it anymore, right? And so The same way we seek for God, we seek His face. Lord, I will not leave until You show me Your face, or You impress upon my heart, or You give me the answer, or You give me the assurance that You heard my cry. Amen? A month in the hospital, by myself most of the time, who else will you turn to? Who else will I turn to but the Lord? Amen? Seek Your face. Lord, I will seek. So, repetition. Seek Your face. I will seek Your face. Isaiah 26, verse 9. My soul yearns for You in the night, and in the morning my spirit longs for You. Isn't that how you felt if you're married? Wasn't that how you felt when you first, you know, fell in love or developed that affection for a loved one or a husband or spouse? You yearn for them. You long for their presence. And I pray that that's how we feel. Lord, I yearn to be in Your presence. I long for You to be beside me. It doesn't have to just be in a closet or in your private quiet time. Wherever you go, let your yearning and longing for God's presence to envelop you, because He is there. Amen. It's just sometimes we block Him out, but He's never left. It's just we are not sensitive to His presence and we don't listen to His voice. So let's practice the presence of the Lord wherever we go. Amen, with yearning and longing. Psalm 63, 1 verse 2 says, You, my God, are my God. Earnestly I seek You. That word again, seek. I thirst for You. My whole being longs for You in a dry and parched land where there is no water. None of us probably experience being in a desert without water, but many of us experience feeling thirst after a dry, you know, spell in the sun, right? Or playing too long outside. But like a deer that longs for the streams of water, let our hearts long for You, my God. Intimacy. If we can be intimate with a friend or a spouse, can we not much more be intimate with the Lord? You know, me and God were like this. Amen. And I know a lot of you can say that. Me and the Lord were like this. We're buddies. He's my best friend. He's my rock. He's my refuge. He's my strength. He's my all in all. He's my healer. When I was in the hospital, I never asked, why me, Lord? I just knew that God has a plan. I just didn't know when, but I was just submissive. Lord, I know You know what You're doing, of course. And I pray that I will pass this test. Give me the strength. I just asked, what's the lesson in this? That I may get it, Lord. I will hear Your voice. And my favorite song when I was sick, listening to Pandora music, so that it's 24-hour radio, Christian music. And for some reason, that song, Thank You for the Cross, always played. And that's what we should remember. Thank You for the cross, Lord. Thank You for the price You paid. Bearing all my sin and shame in righteousness You gave. And so I realized, shall we not share in the suffering as well? I said, Lord, what I'm going through cannot compare what You went through in the cross for me and for all the people out there. My paralysis cannot compare to the lashes You bore, the crown of thorns that You endured, all the mocking, the shame, and all that You endured. It's just a tiny. What I'm going through is just a tiny experience of your suffering. And so, Lord, I will glory in my suffering, knowing that I can experience a little bit of what you went through. I realize how much you love me. Of course, we know that, right? But sometimes when we have to go through tough times for us to really, really realize how much God loves us and how much intimate we are with Him, when there's nothing or no one else to hold on to. Erik shared, right, that his experience for him, God taught him the same thing. The suffering you go through is nothing compared to what God went through for us because of his great love. And then the same way, are we willing to suffer for our family's sake, for our friend's sake? Or are we casual? Lord, I just want the comfort side of Christianity. I don't want to be in the conflict zone. But like Sister Jot told me, Mar, you had to go through that because untested faith is unreliable faith. Our study in James taught us, right? Count it all joy when you go through diverse trials because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. And then it leads for us to become mature and complete in Christ. Amen? Amen. So untested faith is unreliable faith. We become people of firm character when we persevere in the midst of suffering. What I went through is different from what you're going through, but God is doing the same purpose of molding us, making us, refining us to become more and more like Jesus. Amen. Third area where people are casual is in instruction or in the discipleship or study of God's word. Some Christians just open their Bibles on Sundays or only when there's Bible studies. But let's have a hunger daily, because the Word of God is our spiritual food. How many times do we eat? 3 times a day plus snacks like 5 plus midnight snack like 6, right? And we are known, right? The Filipinos are known for love of potlucks and fellowships with food. And I believe that's common to all cultures as well. And if we can love fellowshipping, you know, and eating, let's also desire and love eating from the Word of God. This is our spiritual food, our daily bread. Didn't Jesus, after 40 days of fasting and Satan tempted him, what did he use? Isn't it it is written, he always says, it is written, it is written. Because he fed on daily bread, the scriptures. And so what you put in is what comes out. Right? You can't expect to pour out a glass of juice if you don't put in juice. Right? If we don't feed ourselves the Word of God, when tragedies strike, when tough times happen, that's what we draw out. That's what we draw upon. And again, feed ourselves more as we read God's word. So when I was sick, I couldn't hold the Bible, right? So I just had to rely on gadgets. Praise God for technology. The iPhone, the iPad. So I can listen to episodes of Joel Osteen and all that. Ministers, right? The Word of God can still be preached. I can still hear it. So that's still a daily input into my spirit, into my soul. And so we can't do without the Word of God. Oh, by the way, if you want to go back and listen to old preachings, just go to YouTube, type HGFFA, and you'll see all the messages that have been recorded for the last 2 or 3 months, right? And you can also send that link to your friends so they too can be ministered as well. So go to YouTube, HGFFA, and you'll see all the topics out there that has been recorded so far. Instruction. Psalm 1 verses 1 to 3 said, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers." Amen. How many of you want to be blessed by the Lord and want to be prosperous, not just in the financial realm, but in every way? Let's delight in the Word of God, in the law of the Lord, and meditate on it day and night. B-I-D. Twice a day, at least. And Psalm 19, verses 7 to 11 says, "The law of the Lord is perfect," and what does it do? It refreshing the soul. It's refreshing the soul. "The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart." If you want joy, read the Word of God. "The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eye." If you're depressed, read the Word of God. It'll give you light. "Fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold." If it's more precious than gold, than much pure gold, we toil and work to get paid our salary and wages or commissions. And we invest so much time, 8 hours, 10 hours a day, or 12 hours for some, to go after. Of course, we need that, right? But how much more we desire, because the Word of God is much more than pure gold. Pure gold, the value now is 19,000, almost 20,000 per pound. And you know how much a pound is, right? Not much. How much you weigh? If you got paid in your value in gold, you're worth a lot. Especially if you weigh a lot. Right? But the point is, desire after the Word of God much more than pure gold. Because it's more precious than pure gold. Money cannot buy the power of God's Word. Amen. The healing from God's Word. The deliverance from God's Word. No hospitals can match the healing power of God's Word spoken to you and I as we ask for and plead for healing. And they are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. I don't know anybody that will resist any sweet dessert if they're normal. If they're not on a diet. We love sweets, right? And you know why we eat sweets? It's so that after you eat that, it satisfies, then it closes the appetite, supposedly. That's why you're told, don't eat the sweets first, because you will lose your appetite, because the brains will get satisfied when there's a lot of glucose already, then it closes the appetite center, because it satisfies. And shall we long for the Lord even more like honey, more than honey? Because He satisfies. Are you satisfied in the Lord? Doesn't He satisfy the longing in our hearts? Doesn't He answer our prayer? Sometimes it takes time. We think it's delayed, but God is never delayed. Amen. So you can only draw out what you put in. And here's what I do. You know, I heard of John Maxwell. He would give money when his kids were growing. He would give his kids money so they will read a book. To finish a book, he'd give them $10 or $20. And so I decided I'll do this, right? I let Marna memorize Psalm 23, and I give her $10. And she did. She memorized Psalm 23. And I did it with her. And I memorized it again. I memorized it before, but sometimes you lose some of the verses. And I find it enjoyable, right, doing it with her. And now we're working on Psalm 34, so we're almost memorizing from 1 to 10. I don't know how you're going to do it, but just do it, you know, because that's where we draw from in times of troubles. God will minister because we have the word of God. John 6:68 says, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of life. Wait, I went fast. Of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know you are the Holy One of God. And 2 Timothy says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly handles the word of truth. Avoid godless chatter, because those who indulge in it become more and more ungodly. Amen. Instead of talking about useless things, godless chatter, talk about the word of God. Talk about how God has been faithful. Talk about what God has done for that day. Talk about the prayer that God has answered. Amen. That will encourage someone else and lead people to closer to the Lord. Now, third area where people can be casual is interaction, or in evangelism, or sharing our story to others. God has a vision for this church of 1,000 souls and more. It's not going to happen by accident. It's going to happen by training, meaning intentional, not by chance, but purposefully, with intent that we go after and seek after people. Matthew 28, the ever so used up great commission says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. The Great Commission. That's our mission, evangelism and discipleship. Then once they get discipled, then it's their turn. They will reach out and evangelize, lead people in, then disciple them. And then once they're discipled, then they go out. And that's how it should be. We've been discipled, so let's go out and reach the souls and bring them in, get them discipled, you know. Or sometimes they don't want to come into church. We can disciple them where they are, in the basketball court or wherever they hang out, right? We can do discipleship. And then they go out, they become mature, and then they go out and reach for others. And so that's how the great book of Acts, right, if you notice how they just went out and led people to the Lord and working in the Holy Spirit, leading them. Amen. Colossians 4, 5 to 6 says, be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity, and let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Seasoned with salt. Salt gives flavor. Salt preserves a lot of ways, right? That salt is good. And so God wants us to be full of grace when we deal with people outside, even inside, right? Even our brothers and sisters, let's treat them special because they are. 2 Timothy says, preach the word, be prepared. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. But you keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. So you don't say, Lord, I'm not an evangelist. But you can talk, right? You can write. Even a mute person can share their faith in Christ. So we have no excuse. If you find that your life is a drudgery, it's because you have become a dead sea. Only receiving, 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 nothing goes out, nothing flows out from you. If you find that you're not joyful, you're not happy, or even depressed, because nothing is flowing from you to others. So if you want joy, let the Holy Spirit flow through you and I and minister to the need outside. Amen? I'm not ashamed of the gospel, Paul said, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. Study the life of Paul. It's just so amazing. Like Ryan said, Earl said, Paul, the Apostle Paul, is the hero, right, of his dad, and that's his hero as well. Because imagine what Paul had to live with just for the sake of the call of Jesus. Simply share your story. Your story is not my story. I can tell you, I can share your story the way you can share it because it's personal. Amen. How God, just do your before, then how God, you encountered God, and then the after, how you are now in your relationship with the Lord, and what's in store for you, how you see your future, what's the ministry that God is opening for you, or you're serving Him in what capacity now. That's all there is. That's evangelism. Amen.
You have to preach the gospel in order for people to respond. If you profess to be a believer in Jesus Christ, you're preaching the gospel. And so, listen, church, what kind of message are you preaching? What kind of life are you living? Because when we cower down in the face of suffering, we preach. When we say we believe in Christ and we live a different way, we preach. You know, Jesus said, if you're ashamed of me in this world, I will be ashamed of you in front of my Father and the angels of heaven. Friends, are you ashamed of the gospel? Imagine what it's like to see Jesus face to face and realize that you turned your back on Him. Thanks be to God that Jesus was not ashamed to go to the cross and die naked for you and I. Thank God Jesus was not ashamed of you. Now this is the question. Are you ashamed of the gospel?
So let's not be ashamed of the gospel. Amen. Jesus wasn't ashamed to bear that suffering on the cross for you and I. And I realized, you know, even in the hospital, we can preach. Even on a deathbed, we can preach. How we respond to situations in life preaches a message to those around us. Amen. And I'm just glad that I stood firm, because it's so blessed. Tess, one of my nurses, was amazed how I can still be talking about God. Even though I was so sick, I was still sharing about Jesus. And she was so amazed. And she shared it to her mom. And mom used to come, right, to our church, but now she's coming on a regular basis. And so whatever the cost is to win one soul, we do that. So one of the best ways is friendship evangelism. Win your friends, right? Sometimes they don't want to come to church right away, but they'd come for dinner or coffee or snack, you know, at Starbucks or at your house. Friendship, build friendships. You break down walls and barriers, build bridges and connections. And let's say this, no to clicks. Say no to clicks. Say it, no to clicks. No to clicks. Probably you don't know what a click is, a small exclusive group of people. And that's the tragedy of some churches. A lot of churches have cliques. Someone coming in doesn't feel welcome because they don't feel like they belong. And God forbid that should happen to our church. Let's be all inclusive. Color, race, creed, status in life, welcome them all.
Hi, recently I've been going to this church for quite some time now. There are usually three groups at the church. First, we have the nerds.
I wanna be the very best, like no one ever was.
Then there's the ballers. Think they're so good in basketball. And finally, we have the cool and the stylish group.
Why did I ever bother coming here to begin with?
Amen. Amen. No to favoritism. The power of our testimony doesn't lie in the depths to which we fell before Christ saved us, but the heights to which He has brought us now. Amen. Doesn't matter what your past is. Doesn't matter how bad, how criminal you were, or how self-righteous. But right now, where God has brought you, let that be your testimony. Testimony of thanksgiving of where God is taking you. And lastly, influence. Let's not be casual about reaching out to the community. There's a dying world out there, and the battlefield is out there, and we gotta be soldiers for Christ. We have different gifts, the Bible says in Romans 12:6-8, according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. So whatever your giftings are, just do it for the glory of God and to serve men, the brothers, the brethren here, and to serve outside. I know we're already doing it here among ourselves, but God is opening doors to serve the community as well. And so let's respond to that, because that's how we also evangelize. When we serve the community, they respond to the gospel. Amen. Amen. And so let's be one in unity, hand in hand, go out there and reach out and serve one another and serve outside. Romans 13 says, 8-9, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves has fulfilled the law. Love your neighbor as yourself. So we're supposed to owe no debt except to love one another. I owe to love you. You owe to love me. We owe to love one another. That's the debt we ought to only have, is to love one another. Galatians says, let's not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we don't give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let's do good to all people, especially those who belong to the family of believers. Okay, especially to the family of believers. Because again, by our love, they will know us and they will be attracted. Hey, what's up with that holy ground? They're really like a big family. I want to be part of us. Amen. They're not exclusive. They're all inclusive. All the colors, all the backgrounds, all the status, they're welcome there. So just before we close, training is not accident. Number one, you got to do it regularly. So in all those areas that you and I need to grow, we got to do it regularly. Daily. Takes 21 days to form or to break a habit. You form a good habit and to break a bad habit. And then let's keep growing and increase resistance and distance. Once you've been used to 20 pounds, then it doesn't, you know, challenge your muscles anymore. So you gotta increase that. The same way, you gotta increase your endurance, your tenacity in doing all this, pursuing a spirit-filled life. And then last, the Bible says, always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Fully means fully, 100%. If you study the life of Caleb in the Old Testament, he was known as being one who followed God wholeheartedly. Wholeheartedly. That's why he's been so blessed. He has conquered so many tribes, and God has, blessed him and his descendants after him. And then lastly, there has to be accountability. You know, people that are athletes don't just play for the fun, for the love of the game, but they play to win. Amen? Amen. And the same way we run to run the race for the prize that's there waiting for us. And so when we work on this intercession, intimacy with God, interaction with people, instruction from the Word of God, and in our influence, there has to be accountability. Someone not checking up, but just helping us to grow. And so I want, did you pass out the, okay. We got this from Bible school. It's an accountability question. Maybe just get one per couple if we don't have enough, because there's 60 pieces. If you lose out, let me know so I can have some more made at Office Max. I'll wait till everybody gets. Can we turn on the house lights, please? You keep this in your Bible as a bookmark, right? And I want you to do this with a person who loves you and cares about you. Could be your spouse or a best friend, a close brother. And you do this on a regular basis, maybe weekly or daily with your spouse, right? Accountability questions. So I'll wait till everyone got one or share with your partner. Because if we're going to be intentional, then there has to be a way of checking up on one another. Not to judge one another, right? But to encourage one another to grow in love and maturity. Number one, shall we read it? Our brother didn't get one? Not yet? There's more here on this side. Over here, on the front. The gentleman in the front, and Brother Ricky as well. What was your name, Brother? Ray. Okay, Brother Ray. Okay, I'll remember that. Let's read together. Ready? Go. Number one, have you spent daily time in reading the Bible, in prayer, and communing with the Holy Spirit? Number two, have you had any flirtations or lustful attitudes, tempting thoughts, or expose yourself to any explicit materials which would not glorify God? Number three, have you been completely honest in your financial dealings? Have you spent quality relationship time with family and friends? Number five, have you done your 100% best in your business, job, school, or work as unto God? Number six, have you told any half-truths or outright lies to put yourself in a better light to those around you? Number seven, have you shared the gospel with an unbeliever this week? Number eight, have you taken care of your body through daily physical exercise and proper eating and sleeping habits? Number nine, have you allowed any person or circumstances to rob you of your joy in the Lord? And number 10, have you lied to us on any of your answers today? So you got to do this with someone close to you, right? You can be accountable to them, and you can pray together and grow together in your relationship with the Lord in those five areas. Amen? Because we need that. When we don't expect change, then we make a mockery of what God has done for us. We need to change from glory to glory. The old way is gone, right? The new has come. That's what the Bible says. So if the old keeps resurfacing, then you need deliverance. You need help. And we will help one another, amen, in prayer and in interceding for one another and in resourcing. You know, one of these days, people will come to holy ground. If they need jobs, then we can, you know, point them to the right place. And whatever the need is, food bank and all that, looking forward to that. So why don't we all stand? And wherever we are in our level of growth in the Lord, in all these areas, in prayer, in our worship, in our study of the Word, in sharing our faith to others, and in reaching out to the community in service to the church and outside, may it be our desire is to grow from that level. And it's only by the power of the Holy Spirit that we can grow. Lord, I pray that as we commit ourselves to not be casual about our relationship, about our faith in you, but to be on fire in the Holy Spirit, O God. To be zealous about our love for you. To be passionate, O God, in our service to you. To be compassionate for the souls out there that needs you. God, consume us with your fire. Set us on fire, O God. Lord, if there's dryness, if there is depression, O God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that Holy Spirit quicken each one of us. Quicken each one of us to drink from your rivers of water, O God. And that river of water will overflow through us to others. And joy will spring up, O God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you desire to serve the Lord on a more intense level, where you are, dedicate your life and commit to serve the Lord in the calling that He has for you. In the giftings that He has given you, God will use you mightily. Whatever area of talent or abilities, God will use that. And He will be glorified. So Lord, I pray that as a church, O God, we be united to help one another to grow in love, to grow in the Spirit and bear fruit, O God. And Lord, as a church, we will be a mighty force out there to lead people to Christ, to lead people to salvation, to lead people to change lives, to lead people to discipleship, to bring people, O God, to a higher level of relationship with you, that they too, Lord, may experience the joy and your love that comes from above. Hallelujah. And so, Lord, we commit our lives as a church, one body, one Jesus, one Holy Spirit. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.